Any attempt to replicate yokai behavior would be ill-advised.
Shows something of the diversity at Tokyo Game Show, because here behind me, you've got the Sega stand, you've got the EA stand, which has got very Western games like Need for Speed, Battlefield, FIFA on it. But then right next door, there is a very strange Japanese rhythm action platformer.
The 2011 Tokyo Game Show was jam-packed with releases that everyone was raging about. The 3DS was still fresh and new, the Xbox 360 Kinect was getting a lot of new releases, Asura's Wrath was revealed, I love that game. But there was one really underrated highlight during the Level 5 vision that I want to cover today. A whole new franchise in the works about mythological creatures known as yokai, which would grow to be my favorite franchise of all time, the Yokai Watch.
My name is Brent Pendergrass. I was a voice actor on Yokai Watch.
My username on TikTok is Lazaria Solos. I make Yokai Watch edits, mainly. I make edits of other media as well, but it's mostly Yokai Watch.
Yes, I'm Johnny Awesome. I've been creating YouTube videos on the internet for over a decade.
Okay, so my name is Sage. I have been a Yokai Watch fan for almost 5 years, I think.
And hi, I'm John, the guy narrating. And yes, I am spending my summer avoiding sunlight in my parents' basement to record this video. Being underground like this has always been a big part of my life, aside from just growing up an introvert. It's also really apparent in just the games that I like. I've always had an affinity for the more underrated forms of media and franchises that I don't really seek out because they're popular, it just always happens to be that case where I like something that everyone else hates to their core. For example, most people still won't believe me when I say one of my favorite Pokemon is Simisear. And one of my greatest obsessions of that kind that I want to celebrate today, whose anniversary was a while ago, this video was supposed to come out a while ago, is none other than Yokai Watch for the 3DS.
The first game's definitely like a good, I guess, tutorial on the overall like franchise, and it's just, it's fun, it's really like...
The word I would describe that game is charming. It really is such a charming game.
The demo came out, and my friend at the time, Munching Orange, was like, bro, you should play it. It seems like something you'd like. And boy, oh boy, was he right.
My favorite game was the first one. I think it's good that they have a good balance between humor and seriousness, and I like the story a lot.
Yokai Watch had a huge wave of hype across Japan not too long after that trailer came out. With the manga coming out the following year and the anime not too long after, people were really loving it there. You almost couldn't escape it in restaurants or tour guides or screens in the cities of Japan. It was everywhere. But of course, what I consider the core of it all, what really made Yokai Watch what it is, was the game that came out in 2013. Granted, I was only 8 in 2013 when the game came out in Japan, and I also don't know Japanese, but I was hyped. The world was hyped. Right off the bat, people were calling this things like the Pokemon Killer, the Star Child of the 3DS, it was gonna take over the entire catalog. And it sold really well in Japan on launch, with 55,000 copies going quickly to 500,000 and then in the millions in the first year. But not just the first game, I want to celebrate the whole franchise for everything that it is, so if you'll stick with me for a while, get comfy, get some snacks, because we're about to explore a very, very wonderful world. This is where we meet our protagonist, Nate Adams, an 11-year-old boy who the writers really want to hammer in as the least special person imaginable. He was born with average height, average weight, he cried the average amount as a kid, and he was just never really good at anything, so he wanted some way to stick out amongst his friends. So he gets into a bug-catching competition with them to prove his one value to society, and stumbles up a mountain and down a poorly secured path to an evil sacred tree that no one bothers to worry about. And then there he is, face to face with the gacha machine that changed everything.
Hmm? What's this doing here?
Feed me, feed me!
Whoa! What? Who was that? Who said that?
Feed me, feed me, feed me, feed me, feed me right now!
Where's that coming from? So it wants me to feed it a coin? Huh?
My name is Whisper. I am a yokai. Pleased to meet you. Charmed.
Finally escaping the prison of the balls, we meet Whisper, the very unfortunately shaped yokai responsible for ruining any sense of normalcy for the rest of Nate's life. And after about 15 more minutes of harassing him with his life story about being sealed away for almost 100 years for no reason, he vows to forever be Nate's butler in return and coughs up the yokai watch. He teaches Nate to search for other yokai in things like trees, bushes, under cars, they're everywhere. And the closer you get to something inhabited by a yokai, the more your radar will go off, telling you it's nearby. To start an encounter with a yokai, Nate has to shine his light around the area until the yokai is fully seen in his lens. Bad news though, yokai get kinda pissed having a child follow them around day and night with a bright light and might start a fight. Bars. Luckily, a normal looking cicada that Nate did catch turns into the yokai Kaden and helps him out. Kaden gives Nate his yokai medal, a symbol of friendship and a tool to summon him at any time by putting it in the watch. So now that Nate finally has his first yokai friend, I get to talk to you guys about the battling system, and oh my god, I love wheels! Now, as most of you might know, one of the main complaints about the series is that it's a Pokemon clone, but that mainly just comes from the fact that it gives you a team of up to 6 creatures to use in battle. But no, I want you to take a good look at the screen right here and tell me one other thing that these systems share. Instead of a turn-based 1v1 format, having a full team of 6 turns it into a 3v3 or a 3v1, with only half the team being on the field at a time. I'll try to give a quick rundown of everything, so stay with me, okay? First off, yokai come in one of 8 tribes: Charming, Brave, Mysterious, Heartful, Tough, Slippery, Eerie, and Shady. Putting 3 yokai of the same tribe on the front lines gives them different stat boosts until one of them is in the back lines again. They still have 4 moves they can use, I guess, and the stats are relatively the same, but with a few nice tweaks. Physical moves can be single or multi-hit and use a strength stat. Technique moves use a spirit stat, which is basically a combination of special attack and special defense, and they can be one of the elements: fire, ice, wind, water, earth, lightning, drain, or restore. Inspears can either be buffs that yokai use on themselves or their teammates, or debuffs to use on the enemy. The buffs include things like healing, raising stats, or making one of their teammates a target of the enemy, and the debuffs include things like lowering stats, doing chip damage, or just completely skipping a yokai's turn. And the soul ultimates are unique to every yokai out there and can be used when the soul meter by your HP bar is full. Every yokai will start out with its own preset way it'll act in battle usually that can be changed with items you can get as the game progresses. Rough and Grouchy means they'll focus on physical attacks more, Logical and Brainy means techniques will happen more, Twisted and Cruel focus on negative and spirits more, and so on. As for how the battle itself plays out, you don't have all the time in the world to strategize as each turn goes by. Instead, everything the yokai do is happening in real time for you to keep up with as Nate acts as a support for them. And the battles can get really demanding really easily. You gotta find a window to charge up your soul ultimate to either make or break a tough encounter. You can pin individual yokai to have your team focus on them, and use it to hit wisps floating around to get things like items, soul meter refills, increased befriending chance, and more money. If your team members get a bad in spirit, you gotta rotate the wheel on the watch to put them in the back line so you can purify them by playing other little mini-games similar to the soul ultimates. You gotta feed your team foods and medicines to heal them up, and drinks to restore their spirit bar as they go. Listen, all I'm gonna say is Yokai Watch would be killing it if it came out today. This is like the ultimate stintoy. Oh shit, stop. Over time, the battles are gonna test you more and more on how well you can multitask, especially when it comes to the bosses. For example, in a fight with one of the earlier bosses, Sproink, he takes a lot of cheap shots in his bathhouse battle. He'll throw bars of soap at you that can do a good chunk of damage while also inspiriting a yokai so they can't move, and at the same time he'll hide his face behind his bucket so if your yokai aim there you'll barely do any damage until you throw a pin at his very grossly exaggerated belly button, and they'll focus there. Or a later boss, Dr. Madaman, has you really pull out the stops by focusing the pin on the environment around you. While he's able to inspirit your whole team and deal big chip damage, at the same time hearts will appear in the background as the battle goes on. You need to hit those with your pins, otherwise he'll restore HP with any that are left floating around. But you also need to worry about making sure your team can even make it through the battle with all its poison and confusion and spirits and generally hefty attacks. Pop them on before his blood refill though, and he basically has a heart attack, leaving you free to wail on him as much as you want. It does such a good job of keeping you on your toes as the game goes on that there's rarely any opportunity to feel too strong to where you're just mindlessly blowing through it all. I get that feeling a lot in turn-based RPGs, which usually leads to a lot of burnout, but this just hasn't ever been one of them for me. And what's also better is the type chart, besides draining and healing, being one big chain of one element being weak to another instead of a bunch of fucking yarn. And one last thing I want to appreciate, tying into the battle part, is how you befriend yokai and the personality that it all adds to them. After every normal encounter, there's a chance that a yokai on the opposite team will come up to you asking if they can join you after the windscreen. You can say yes or no, and if you accept them, they'll give you their medal and join the team. You can increase this chance by feeding them food or drinks in battle, with every yokai having their favorite and least favorite. And there's higher, more expensive tiers of food that you can buy later on that'll increase the chance even more. Feeding a yokai their favorite food or drink will give them a heart floating above their head, and their least favorite will give them a little black squiggle. And feeding your own yokai their favorite or least favorites will increase or decrease the restorative effects. It's a nice touch that I like to watch as their little afterlife coach, and I'm much happier raising a team of already dead friends and live creatures that I captured to fight for my own benefit, you know? I'm just saying, PETA could never touch this. Oh yeah, I skipped ahead a bit, didn't I? Yeah, we kinda tore that bird apart a while ago. Well anyway, with the bug, the bird, and the butler now in tow, it's time to begin Nate's very non-consensual journey with a new world of yokai. The story first plays out as a small chain of mysteries around Nate's hometown, Springdale. This is when he realizes that yokai really are everywhere, and they're kind of the leading cause of a lot of problems. We meet everybody's favorite Jibanon, who's been causing a lot of traffic troubles as of late, and then we gotta stop this thing from making our parents divorce for some reason. For the most part, Nate's just busy helping out around town in general wherever he's needed until his first big mission begins. In his many quests around town, Nate learned about some rumors of yokai destroying the protective seals, keeping out some dangers of the yokai world. So after some further investigation of the seals and taking down the yokai responsible, Whisper can still sense a huge mass of spirit energy surging from the elementary school. They check out the seal in the schoolyard, which luckily still looks intact, but with the others already weakened so far, the power is still able to take form as we meet our first boss, Slimomander. It's a really hard-fought first battle, but Nate does come out on top somehow. That is until Slimomander gives it one last fire breath in hopes of finishing him off, but a much-needed aide swoops in and bitch slaps that cheap shot and strikes back even harder. As that mysterious yokai ninjas away though, this is basically Nate's signal of, yeah, you need to get stronger because I am not helping you again. So with Whisper's recommendation, it's time to head to the neighboring town, Blossom Heights, in search of an upgrade for the yokai watch. Nate discovers the watch shop in this town, Timers and More, is actually run by a yokai disguised as a human, Mr. Goodsight. He says he can upgrade the yokai watch for you, but first, you need to run some errands. Go get some watch parts for the upgrade from some friends of Mr. Goodsight around town, go befriend Baku so you can go out at night without your parents knowing you're gone, and go to the bathhouse and get my Northern Left Unit to go. Please. Those first two parts are relatively easy, but the real fun part comes when he finally goes out for the first time at night. The second Nate steps out of his door, the yokai raider stops, the countdown begins, and the fog rolls in. You see, children are kept inside at night for a reason, to protect them from all the dangers of the dark. But even so, you may be tempted to go out and question of, what dangers exactly? Well, I'm here to tell you of the biggest of them all, Gargaros. Terror time is a random event that can happen at any time of day, but mostly at night. It's a seemingly time-frozen zone where only he, his yokai, and the Oni reside. Your only, and I mean only, job in this event is to stay hidden from the sentries searching for you, because if they find you, they'll alert Gargaros, and he is a super boss that you are not surviving at this point, and you will not be surviving for a while. Over time, there will be a door that appears to let you escape to the real world again, but for now, Nate just has to stay hidden. There are, however, treasure boxes scattered around to entice you to explore a bit, but they're heavily guarded by the sentries. If you can sneak your way around them and get to them, they have some pretty good items, just, you know, accept your consequences if you fail. He wanders up to the elementary school as he's still lost on where to go at this point, and wouldn't you know it, Mr. I'm not helping you out again helps us out again and brings out the door. So with Nate back on his mission, he can head to the bathhouse and spend all night wrestling a sweaty pig for underwear that belongs to neither of them, and then he can go back to Timers and More and upgrade his watch to D rank. The way the game handles the watch upgrades makes the progression feel really smooth in my eyes. There are these doors scattered around the world that require the watch to be a certain rank before you can go through, and while there are a couple that are required for story progression, you can get pretty far before you have to do the quest to upgrade the watch. And I really appreciate how, with this game taking place in this one big condensed city, every area around you still remains relevant because you keep finding more and more stronger yokai in the same areas that you just couldn't see before. Now, before we get into the big bulk of the plot, there's just a couple more early game mechanics that I want to get into really quickly. First off is that you can revisit the Krankakai on Mount Wildwood and use special coins to get items or yokai out of it. The coins come in different colors representing each type of yokai they can give you, and they can be found in item boxes around the world or in download codes online. You only get to use the Krankakai 3 times per day though, and the game will not allow you to change the clock to exploit that. If you try, you'll just get a cutscene of Gargaros telling you off, basically like Rossetti, the next time you open your save file. Do it enough times and you won't be able to use the crank yokai for the next 24 hours, so make your cranks count. And next up, while most yokai evolve normally through level up, shut up, some can have their souls fused with another yokai or with their specific fusion item at Shoten Temple to become something even greater. And I just like this concept. I love fusion in any form of media ever, all the time. One thing that I always found interesting though is that, in the manga and anime which I'll cover more later, fusion isn't permanent like it is here. Yokai are seen unfusing with their item or partner yokai whenever they want, which means when you put the fusion's metal in the watch, they're basically just carpooling into the summoning and fusing before Nei even realizes it. And I just always thought that was kind of funny. Anyways, now with the basics covered, the rest of the story follows Nei, Whisper, and Jibanyan helping out around the city, dealing with more and more yokai troubles and learning as much as they can about the broken seals, ultimately learning about a much bigger threat that's been lurking in the background all this time. The king of all yokai, Lord Enma, had been mysteriously absent for a very long time. So the chairman of a corrupt yokai political party had taken over in all the confusion, and began scheming a plan to take out the world barriers in a fashion that I can only really describe as some sort of weird Florida headline. Hold on. This just in, newly crowned overlord of the spirit realm, a squid dressed as the Pope, has rallied an army of the dead to whitewash all of Japan. Back to you. So with an army soon approaching and being one who can gather yokai and train them as well as he has, Nei takes up the responsibility himself to fight for the fate of both worlds. One problem though, they need a way into the yokai world. One solution, Lucas. One of Nate's classmates, Lucas Siffer, comes to him in a panic because he's been feeling crazy. Not rat crazy, but like, yokai crazy. Lucas can see yokai. He tells Nate about a dream he's been having about traveling to the yokai world using a key he just has. And it's never really stated in game, but it seems most likely that local yokai told Lucas about all Nate's efforts and led him to his house. Which, yeah, no privacy. So with Nate being really the only person Lucas can go to, he hands over the key and they go to Mount Wildwood, where it turns out the tree that Whisper was sealed in hides the elevator to the yokai world. So the gang met by Insomni heads down the elevator and Nate gets his first glimpse at the yokai world. It's a really extravagant and colorful world just by looking at the entrance, but the excitement does not last long because we're met by the mysterious aide, who now reveals himself as Venokt, and who upon seeing Lucas in the yokai world, freaks the fuck out, like, yo, my one job is to make sure he's not here, get out, and then he goes in for the attack. So after a long, hard fought blood bet, yeah, Nate won. So now that he's cooled down and actually wants to talk about things, he furthers the story of McCracken's takeover. He explains that while yokai do have a much, much longer lifespan than humans, their afterlives do come to an end at some point. Knowing that his time was coming, King Enma had two dreams that he wanted to pass on to his people for the future of all yokai. For humans and yokai to have a healthy bond through the power of the Watch, and for his son to be raised well until his powers could awaken and he could lead the world. When McCracken struck, they needed any chance they could get to protect their world and their king's dreams. So they sent his son to the human world and erased his memories of the yokai world in hopes that he remained safe that way. As for the yokai watch, whether it be fate or just really, really lucky coincidence, it finally ended up in Nate's hands, one of the few humans in history to finally accept yokai for who they are. Venokt, after watching all of Nate's adventures and everything he'd overcome, finally believes that he might be exactly what the yokai world needed and could keep Lucas safe. Recognizing his worth, he hands over his yokai medal and joins Nei's team as his first S-rank yokai, the strongest of them all. So they start their storm through the yokai world, passing gate after gate after gate until they get to beat the ever-loving shit out of McCracken. To which he aptly responds, "Alright, forget the whole battle of attrition, I'll just break the barrier now." So heading back to the human world, everything's worse. And it's time to go back around and reseal all the powerful yokai that are leaking out everywhere. But really, by powerful yokai leaking out, I mean a bunch of monochrome scrubs and Slimamander again, so we're fine. No, the only thing we really need to worry about is what's happening back on Mount Wildwood. Back at the tree, he's absorbing every single ounce of spirit energy and elemental power from every yokai he can find, and he finally reaches his final form, turning into okay. Final battle. And it's a pretty hard fight. He throws every single element possible at you, and he steals your soul meter constantly to spam his own soul ultimate, which can wipe you out pretty good. Not to mention, his constant confusing in-spirits to make you attack your own team makes it a really hard to balance fight. But if you can push through all of that, then you can finally fulfill your destiny and save both worlds. But at what cost? Everyone around you can see that he's down for good. He's not coming back up. But even Nate himself gets the feeling that it's not really over. All the yokai turning to Nate knew the whole time that the only guarantee they had of no more threats coming to this world was to seal away the elevator and separate the worlds forever. Even with how reluctant Nate is to accept it at first and how much he wants to refuse it with everything he's got, both he and Whisper knew it was coming since the very beginning. With one last look around at everybody he's helped and everybody who helped him get to where he is, he's ready to let go.
This talisman will be just the thing we need to take care of the elevator. We're now closed for business.
Whisper.
My time as your butler has come to an end. We must now go back to our own world. However, you must not worry. This is not a moment for sadness. I'm sure we'll meet again. And with that, I shall take my leave. Goodbye for now.
Despite all the grief that may have come with it, Nate can look over the town, knowing he did the best thing for both worlds. Yeah, no, for a kid's game, that was actually really hard for me to record without my throat swelling. This is something you'd never really expect to bring a tear to your eye, but it's one of the few that can actually get me close every single time I finish it. The balance this game has between comedy and genuine heartfelt moments is something that anybody would struggle with at least a bit to achieve, especially with their target audience. It's a balance that I try my best to mimic throughout this, but it's not an easy feat to pull off what they did without taking away from either side. And it's especially a hard feat for me because I am permanently monotonous. In a way that I could never fully explain, this game is just beautiful. It's something that I really love to talk about, but even more than that, I love to hear other people talk about what it means to them.
Oh, the music. I love the music for Yo-Kai Watch. It's like, I think is one of the main reasons why I stuck around. Like, the music, especially in the first game, it's so good. Like, I could listen to it on repeat for ages. Especially, I think my favorite's gotta be the final boss music for both Yo-Kai Watch 1 and Yo-Kai Watch 4.
I got used to it. I know that a lot of people didn't like that. It's like, oh, I gotta draw a figure eight to punch somebody in the face. Like, this is super weird, but at the same time, it was like, it's keeping you moving. It was something different. It was totally different. And I actually learned to really enjoy it. And that's something I'm like, I'm probably not going to be super into this game. I know I'm in it, but it's like, this is not for me. I don't play these, like, I play like Arkham Knight and things like that. But I just sat down. I remember I was homesick or I had like an injury and I had to take a Vicodin. And I was all crushed on Vicodin and the 3DS, and I had the game, and my 3DS just came in the mail that day. And I remember I sat there and played it for like 4 or 5 hours, just so calm on pain medication. I'm just like, the game was so relaxing. I just kind of got addicted to it.
20 hours into that one, but it felt like just the complete package. And it really, it wasn't just a fun collect them all game, right? It was a story about generations and, you know, like letting go. I think it had such a powerful message for a kids game that I haven't seen anything replicated like that since.
So with that, the adventure is far from over, as we still got a pretty solid postgame to conquer. You see, there's a whole nother part of the yokai world we haven't introduced yet, with threats greater than anything he's encountered. The Infinite Inferno is where all the greatest evils of the world are contained, and where one of the most powerful creatures imaginable sleeps, concealed to prevent a calamity. And guess what? The seal's broke! So yeah, you're definitely gonna need some stronger yokai for this mission, and for that, you're gonna need a stronger watch. One last trial of some of his toughest opponents ever, and Nate can finally get his last yokai watch upgrade, the S rank. His search for clues on the Infinite Inferno leads him to a mansion in Breezy Hills where he meets Mr. Stone, one of the few other people who can see yokai naturally. He tells Nate that off the side of Blossom Heights lies a tunnel leading to an open field that he and his wife used to visit, accompanied only by a wooden shed. Nothing in particular happened there, as they both share happy memories, but he remembers a feeling of such great evil that traumatized him so bad that he can only believe it to be a dream. However, talking to his wife reveals that no part of it was a dream. She still has the key that they found on their final visit to that place, that she kept away in hopes that nothing would come out of it. She tells him that it felt like fate that he visited today, and she gives him the key to the shed, which basically translates to, hey, you're the protagonist, your problem now. So after upping his team and maybe collecting certain yokai to unlock the S-rank legendaries in the back pages of the medallion, Nate makes his way to the tunnel that used to be blocked off for the entirety of the game. He unlocks the lone shed lying in the expansive serene field of Prayer's Peak, and takes his headfirst dive into the pits of hell. Immediately upon making his way down, Nate's met with yokai telling him that he's gotta have a death wish to stumble his way down here. The Infinite Inferno is a long series of layers of mazes lined with super high level yokai of all ranks. You battle your way through eight circles of this dimension, referencing the circles of hell, with each having stronger and rarer yokai lying about, and with each layer ending with a harder recolored version of the story's bosses. It's honestly a really challenging run that'll likely make you stop to train or swap out yokai and equipment before you prepare for the next boss, ultimately leading to the 8th circle containing the real reason we're here, the ultimate creature that thousands of yokai perish trying to seal away, the final boss, Wobble Walk. Yeah, he's pretty cheery for the most destructive threat in the history of yokai, but he's a hard fight. Of course he's got the usual fuck you take every in spirit in the book, as well as just being a heavy hitter. But his main gimmick that makes this one of the most balls-to-the-walls fights in the entire series comes from the fact that he can swap between being immune to physical attacks and being immune to technique attacks, and that goes for all Sultimates too. I think it works really well as one final trial, focusing on your multitasking during the battle and how you plan out your team before it. And if you're feeling confident, you can even take on Gargross and Terratime. Take him down and you can walk around and collect all the treasure boxes you want with nothing to worry about. Well, nothing to worry about except the two stronger Oni that come after him, but you know, you got it. Beyond that, collect every yokai you can to fill your medallion. You can battle with other players online and even trade with them if you have them registered in your 3DS friends list. And though I always try to restrict it until like post-game so it's not too easy, there's a lot of special items you can get with internet download and promo codes that I mentioned earlier by going to the post op or the bank. Now, I think it's safe to say the game lived well beyond the hype that was following it for so long. But the game was just a start. The hype kept growing and spawning more and more projects, and two main factors of that I want to cover as well are the manga and the anime. In these, we still get the same origin story of Nate stumbling up Mount Wildwood and meeting Whisper, but the focus of their content, along with the storytelling, the pacing, the character writing, and the overall vibe is a lot different from the games. Rather than follow one continuous plotline, these are a lot more comedy-focused and episodic. The manga, written by Noriyuki Konishi, follows a more Monster of the Week type formula, with yokai just kinda messing around with their environment. Despite how much people complain about the comedy, I actually thought it was really funny. I ended up reading this a lot in high school whenever I was done with my work, and I had to hold in laughter a lot, and I kinda looked insane doing it, but I just really liked it. They had a few good serious arcs that they did really well, but overall it was just kinda potty humor, and sometimes it worked, sometimes it didn't. And the way each episode of the anime is segmented is really interesting to me as well. It also follows a Monster of the Week type formula, but also it's segmented into the main focus of the episode and a bunch of little skits that'll go on for like 5 minutes. And with these two being mostly comedy-based rather than just pure action, it does a really good job at making the yokai feel more like characters. One of my favorite things that the anime does is the watch summons, because every tribe has their own little theme that they get when they're summoned, and it really adds to the character and flair of them.
people probably mostly know me as being the summoning voice, the summoning Charming, that guy. And I think I really like the legendary song, the way it goes. Like, that's my favorite to hear. But it's the one that I actually sing that I'm most attached to is a song I cannot freaking remember right now. It's driving me nuts. Because it's not tough. That's the gruff stuff. Like, oh, and when I write those songs, all of them, I wrote fully like articulate lyrics to those songs that all made sense to the tribe. And they sent back notes were like, these are great. Don't do that. We want it to be nonsense. I'm like, oh, okay. So I would literally, like, when I wrote that gruff stuff, rough, bluff, red band, jacket stand, bling, bling, tough.
Yeah.
I was watching a red band trailer, which is an R-rated trailer. Instead of green, it's red. And I looked up and there was a coat rack. So I just said, red band, jacket stand, bling, bling, tough. When I sent all those in, they were like, these are perfect. I'm like, okay.
You can tell that, especially with the manga, the humor is a lot more eccentric in these two, and I really like how the over-the-top expressions just keep going. Yeah, I can get how at a point it's definitely going to get obnoxious. Like, over time in the manga, they do a lot more body humor and piss jokes, but it has its ups and downs. Nate's character really shines in the anime and the manga, because while in the games he's still a really nice kid and he's funny, but in the anime and the manga, he's just a dick and I like it.
That's, like, everything about yokai is, like, this needs to be weird. Everything needs to be weird. We need to have gross-out humor every once in a while. It has to be... They always wanted it, to really connect with kids about, like, their most embarrassing moments. Like, to really, you know, Nate has so much embarrassing stuff and just, like, the things that would happen or, you know, what people would say to him and he'd get embarrassed. It was, like... It was perfect. You know, they had the sleepover where they're watching, I know they're watching, like, Skinamax in the Japanese one. I don't know what they changed it to in this one, but it was like I think it was just like a beauty pageant or a music video they're watching with girls they like, but I think the Japanese one is like way more ridiculous, whatever, like, late night movies they're watching. You know, and I remember being a kid. And I'm so old, when I was a kid, we had, you know, a clicker on the thing, but on channel 99 was like the adult channel. You could hear everything, but it was all scrambled. So seeing that, I'm like, oh, wow, yeah, that's like when I was a kid, I remember seeing this stuff. So I thought it did a really good job of maybe even directed at kids that might be considered outsiders, kids that, you know, aren't the jock or the super, like, popular kid at school. It was like, it was all about being a normal kid and growing up with awkward situations, embarrassment, your first crush, things like that. And it's just such a charming, no pun intended, such a charming show. It really was. And I'm really proud of it. And it makes, like I said, it makes me happy when people get that. It's not just like action and there's stuff like that in it, but it's more like I feel like people could connect to it more. The characters are so good that you could get attached to them a little bit more than like something that's just like pure action and fighting. It's like really about your life as a kid.
Yo-Kai West deserved every single ounce of hype that it got, and I'm really glad that it got to see so many mini projects and mini side games to go with it. One of which I really want to cover because it's a really good example of a good side game is Yo-Kai Watch Wibble Wobble, taking the formula of Disney Tsum Tsum and, you know, putting Yo-Kai Watch characters on it. And if you don't know what Disney Tsum Tsum is, I don't blame you. It was a thing for like a week. You drag your finger on the screen to match things with others of the same thing, things pop, things happen, it's one of those mobile games. But it was still a really nice game to play as it had a combat system in the puzzles and a gambling system to boot. It's like you took that formula of Disney Tsum Tsum and mix it with like puzzles and dragons.
To all the people that I accidentally got addicted to gambling because of Yo-Kai Watch, Wibwob, and Puni Puni, I am sorry. But you, like, come on, like, don't, like, I'm addicted too, I'm a victim too, okay? Like, you know, come on, it's not my fault.
Another one I want to take a look at is Yo-Kai Watch World, which, yeah, okay, I'll take this one, it's basically Pokemon Go. But it was 2016, 2017, everyone was doing it, and don't lie to me and tell me this trailer doesn't look fire. Like with most people in America, I never really heard of it as I'm just watching the trailer for the first time right now, and I never got to play it because the servers shut down in 2022. And from what I found, there was no English footage whatsoever, so I can only assume it just stayed a Japanese exclusive. And yeah, there's nothing I really can say about it, because there's no way I could have experienced it. But from what I saw, it looks like something I would have played the hell out of, so I think it looks cool. Yo-Kai Watch also has a lot of random, really neat crossovers and references. Especially going back to Wibble Wobble for a second, because you've got characters from Sanrio, Attack on Titan, The Seven Deadly Sins, Inazuma Eleven, and then you've got Yo-Kai Watch appearances in other games like Danganronpa and Final Fantasy. And with the Final Fantasy collab spawning one of my favorite memes where, canonically, Jibanyan has fought Sephiroth and probably won, these just always bring me a smile thinking about them. And of course I can't forget the premiere of the first Yo-Kai Watch movie. To this day, I can still remember the feeling of watching this in my Nana's basement for the first time after all day waiting for it to premiere on Disney XD, and I was so excited. To see something you love this much grow like it is, it's so heartwarming, and I loved watching this movie and I loved everything the series brought to me. But speaking of the movie, the events follow the plot of our next title, Yo-Kai Watch 2, a fan favorite of literally everyone. Literally every person who I asked if they liked the games or not had this as their number one. And it's something that I'm also really excited to talk about.
Ah, the Yo-Kai Watch. The loathsome device that connects humans and yokai
has no place in our ideal world.
The next morning, Whisper, Jibanyan, and the watch are all gone, but he still feels normal, he doesn't remember any of it. So he just moves on with his morning to go shopping with his parents in Shopper's Row on their first day together in a long time from what I know. For most of the day, it's just a really nice family outing until they stop between two rival donut shops which his parents can't decide which one to buy from. So guess what, they spark a whole crowd to join the argument and put it all on the 11-year-old to decide their fate, both as a couple and as a game. In the base games, you'll be locked into choosing either the Spirit Donuts or the Soul Donuts based on your game's title. In Psychic Spectres, though, you're free to choose either one, which will alter what yokai you encounter in the game and a few more things I'll get to in the future. Anyways, dodging another near divorce probably a few months at most after the last one, Nate just dips on his parents for a while to go for a walk and finds Eddie and Bear flexing their new Rolexes, which gives him a strong sense of deja vu. So after hanging out with his friends for the rest of the day, Nate goes to the new memory shop that he found to look for some answers. There, he finds the Yo-Kai Watch in a display case, but it's completely unrecognizable to him. The shop owner really recommends it to Nate and only sells it to him for a dollar, and then tells Nate that he should go put a coin in the machine outside.
Huh? Is this it? Let's see. Ah, this is just a rock, isn't it? This is so lame.
Hey! Now wait a minute! Are you seriously going to throw away your hard-earned money like that?
A talking rock?
Enough chit-chat. Open the capsule already. I'll explain later.
Okay.
Why, hello! My name is Whisper. I am a yokai. You set me free. I shall become your butler. Charm!
Yokai?
So coming out of the capsule machine, which, fuck if I know how he got stuck in another one, Whisper's memories are gone too. But upon their reunion, the watch starts to glow and a huge swirl of energy bursts out and their memories are returned. So as they're both still dumbfounded as to what just happened, they search out Jibanin and find him at the traffic light where he is 0-for-2 on the cars. But hey, they give him some consolation after absolutely being demolished again, and as the light glows, his shameful memories come back too. So with the gang back together again, the first couple chapters of this are just to ease you back into the gameplay. You've got the tutorial battle, fighting another sweaty, obese yokai over a stolen object, a night mission at the school with a 4-story tall skeleton haunting it, watch upgrade, all the works. And there's some really neat new features here like baffle boards. These signs will show up on the radar for you to search the area for. These will all have you enter a yokai's name based on 3 hints that the sign gives you. If you get it right and have the yokai befriended, it'll affect the area around you somehow. Like the first one you enter, someone's hunger amps to give the Everymart some more business. And another little thing that was just a really, really perfect addition, you can choose yokai besides Whisper to follow you around now. Or you can go alone. Which, yeah, already makes this a perfect game, I know. The next morning, there's another crisis in Shopper's Row unrelated to Nate's parents for once. Over there, things are getting big. Literally. Heading over there, the gang finds the objects are going to at least 10 times their size out of nowhere. So searching the area for the inflation yokai responsible, they find a giant floating cat which turns out had been looking for Nate the whole time. So he pulls out a move that he can use once and never again and shoots out a giant snot laser at Nate to hypnotize him, giving him a strong urge to visit his grandmother in a new town, Harrisville. And this is where the big, big addition comes in. The most peak part of any gameplay you've ever seen. So Nate grabs a day pass to write as much as he wants before the day ends and the waiting begins. You gotta wait for the sign to appear on the top of the screen giving you your line so you can get to your right destination. From Springdale Central Station where we start out, you have the choice between a line with a bunch of small stops or a longer non-stop line until you get to Fortune Place. And then from Fortune Place you can go to either Harrisville or San Fantastico, another optional town. On the train, there's occasional yokai battles or pretty charming NPC scenes that can get you little items while you wait to arrive. I know the waiting can definitely get annoying, especially when you're waiting there for a while and you get every line except for the one you want. I'm a little bit biased because I grew up adoring trains as a kid as much as humanly possible, but I also just find the yokai battles on the train pretty charming because knowing that other people can't see what's going on besides Nate, he's either causing a whole ass scene by himself or he's just like, so Nate finally arrives to Harrisville Station Plaza and then has to take the bus to get to actual Harrisville. Which, funny story from my first time playing this game, I got stuck here because of that. You see, I always spend all my money on food and items first thing because I just want my yokai to survive, and I wasn't expecting to be gatekept by a whole ass $3 bus fare, I know, a fortune to me. And I didn't have the patience to go back through the whole train process to sell some items so I could go back and ride again. So I had to spend like 30 minutes grinding in these 3 spots going in and out of the train station so they'd respawn, doing that over and over until I scraped together just enough spare change to see my grandma. And again, station workers and police nearby can't see yokai, so from their perspective, little schizo 11-year-old going,
fight back, nigga! Fight back, nigga! Fight back! Fight back!
Anyways, Harrisville's a quiet little countryside town where Nate's dad grew up. He meets his grandmother by the bus stop where she's waiting to take him shopping on a little escort mission before they make it to the house. Overall, there isn't too much to this town right off the bat, but there is another new mechanic, sorcery, where you can pay a monk to rip out the souls of yokai who trusted you to be a caring friend and use them to power up a better yokai since he'll never be able to attain a physical form again. Alright, calm down, don't worry. He does it for free. You can also use unused soul gems to upgrade one you like, or combine certain ones to get unique effects. And I think it's a nice second option for extra buffing because this game gets pretty hard pretty quick. The next day, in another donut-related incident, an offering to Nate's grandfather's shrine starts floating and growing again and flies out the house. Nate and the gang follow it where it disappears in front of the shed outside. Searching the area, they find the inflation yokai is stuck in the shed somehow. When he reveals that he'd actually been stuck in there for 60 years and had just been sending out fractions of his energy to search out for Nate. Now that Nate's here, he's ready to get out of the shed, but he's kinda stuck, so they need to wring him out a bit. Using an object called the Time Stone like the yokai in the opening cutscene had, he sends everybody 60 years into the past where there's a new old threat and a new old hero they need to take it down. People in the past are concerningly hostile as a man approaches Nate with a cloud over his face. Alongside him is apparently some evil shadowy blob creature that Nate can't see, but the yokai can. As they're freaking out, the creature inhabiting the man moves to whisper, and as he goes to attack, he gets smacked on the head with a wooden bat by a really angsty looking preteen. This is Nathaniel Adams, Nate's grandfather, and the original creator of the Yokai Watch. And also a superhero. Nathaniel and Hovernyon take everyone to their hideaway in a treehouse where they explain the situation. These creatures are known as the Wicked Yokai, and they've been taking over the towns left and right at this point. And with no one like Nate able to rally strong yokai like he does in this time, they kinda ended up winning. So the whole plan seems pretty simple to Nate: gather a bunch of strong yokai in this era and help take him down, but Nathaniel refuses. Or at least until Nate can prove himself capable, because Nathaniel doesn't believe yokai are really as reliable or friendly as he says. So to start Nate's adventure in the past, he's out to befriend some yokai of this era known as classic yokai, who are much more closely related to real-life mythological yokai instead of, you know, these. He also befriends Miradox, the evolution of the fast-travel yokai Mirapo, who can send you back and forth through time. So, taking an old-fashioned steam engine trip, you're now able to explore Old Springdale. And I love how everything on the map connects as one big city, since that's what Springdale used to be before all the modernization and skyscrapers. And of course, like with the rest of this series, the music is spectacular. I used to ride around on the bike just listening to this for like, maybe 10 minutes. And I just love steampunk stuff and rustic aesthetic and... God, I sound so Gen Z right now. I don't know what I'm talking about. The place looks cool. There is still a big problem in this town though, as all the factory workers are too lazy to work anymore. Although, the more you think about it, and their work conditions in this time period is probably not the worst thing, but we gotta fix it! But before Nate can investigate the mysterious fog coming from the factory, he's met by Nick from the memory shop way back. Or, I guess, way forward. He recognizes Nate and laughs, tossing him a marble that'll let him see the Wicked Yokai. Defeating the yokai in the factory responsible for the smog reveals that the Wicked Yokai are actually just taking over normal yokai and making these things happen. Heading back to the treehouse, Nate hands over the parts and Nathaniel can finally finish his original design for the Yokai Watch, the Model Zero. Hovernyon really wants Nathaniel to wear the watch, but he still refuses to use any help from Yokai himself and storms off. Hovernyon tells Nate that Nathaniel did have a bunch of Yokai friends at one point, but when the Wicked attacked and he was unable to protect them, he just... isolated himself. He never ended up getting their medals, but he did have milk caps with their names on them, so Nate agrees to find them and befriend them. Only thing is, when the Wicked attacked, they were cursed and turned to stone. So they have to go to the present to see if the curse wore off a bit so they can turn them back. So while Nate's busy wrangling all of them, I get to talk about some new battle mechanics. You can toggle the Model Zero on and off in battle by tapping the middle part, and it'll show some key new features. One of which being my favorite addition to the game, the poke button, or as I like to call it, spiritual harassment. It swaps out the pin button for an opportunity to directly poke their soul? I don't really know how they describe this working visually, but when you inspirit an enemy, you can tap on them until the timer runs out or until the circle fills with an effect, and the effects change depending on where you tap. Some spots deal more damage, some spots give you more money at the end of the battle, some spots make them more likely to befriend you, and there's like a secret insta-kill spot if you can find it, which is weird. This mode also swaps out normal ultimates for Moxie's ultimates, or M skills. If the two yokai surrounding the one using the ultimate have their soul meters full, you can use a boosted version of that ultimate and use all their soul meters. Honestly, I always thought this one more of a detriment than anything, because the boosted ultimates never really made up for the fact that I just can't use ultimates much after that, but I still think it's really cool. So after getting all the classic yokai back together, Nate heads back to the treehouse only to be ambushed by Kin and Gin, starting our first duel boss of the series. And it's a pretty easy one, I just like how you have to use the pin to stop them from using the time stone to revive each other. After the battle, they do still revive because plot, so the classic yokai come together to form a binding circle while Nathaniel jumps from the treehouse and smacks him silly. Dude's got an arm. So with that, the Wicked are pretty much taken care of, Nathaniel finally accepts yokai and Nate has his sidekick, and they can go back to the present. So for the first time ever in this series, Nate can finally just sit and enjoy a vacation. That is until he has to stop a hurricane demon from wiping out Springdale because he saw Yokai PDA and gets no bitches. But hey, at least he gets a new bike at the end of it. And then like immediately after, Hovernyon pulls up again asking Nate to stop a war. You see, these games get their titles, Bony Spirits and Fleshy Souls, from long-standing warring factions between yokai. And right now, 60 years ago, a big historical battle is brewing between them. So as the scene fades to the battlegrounds, we meet the leaders of these factions, my boys. Total Dude and Arachnus, the sassy men, are fighting. So yeah, depending on what version you have, you'll either be siding with Arachnus and Venokt, or Total Dude and QB. And you'll have a chance to recruit them later on after the story. So you meet with your respective war general, and they send you on a really long series of battles and a really long game of Capture the Flag. So after finally defeating the other side's general, Nate wants an answer to what this war is all about so he can stop it. And you're never gonna guess it, but I'm gonna give you 5 seconds to think of a reason why they might go to war for several hundred years like they just did. Would you believe me if I said it was the donuts again? So yeah, this whole time they were just arguing about what type of donuts to give the King Enma on their visit to his palace. And this argument lasted so long, with assuming no present resolution, that he just fucking died. So, good job, boys. Well, anyways, oh hey, the Wicked are back. Keen and Gin return to the battlefield with their actual boss named Dead Time, wielder of time and the biggest drama queen I've ever seen to date. And she sends out an underling Wicked Yokai who's far beyond the rest, just to give Nate a taste of what he's got to deal with in the future. Past. I hate time travel. This is Unfairy, the newest of the elite Wicked Yokai, and he even gives the generals a good mix-up. He moves fast and has really good defenses, forcing the generals to actually put him in a binding circle for the others to get away. So with that, Hover Neon has to throw out a backup plan as their only chance to get strong enough to defeat them. An old yokai of legend, hopefully generous enough to train them in his most powerful art. So they seek him out in Old Springdale, searching high and low for any clue of his whereabouts, asking yokai all around for any sort of information, but to no avail. Maybe he's already gone from this world. Maybe he's too powerful to exist, or maybe he's just a myth. Maybe our best shot is just turning around and trying our best to deal with what we- Oh hey, what's that? So after a quick training arc, undergoing trials training their speed, strength of their bodies, and strength of their hearts, he gives them a box containing exactly what they need. One of his most powerful weapons, only to be used when they really, really need it. Upon returning to the field, they find the generals really tired out after holding off Unfairy for so long, but the tides are finally in their favor. The MacGuffin is in their hands. One faint call from Master Nyada and Whisper opens up their trump card and- I love this franchise. Meanwhile, Dead Time's been absorbing all the spirit energy the Wicked Yokai collected to power up and re-expel it across time, taking over Japan in the past and the present. After they take down Unfairy, she decides to confront Nate herself and sends them to an evil future. In this future, the Wicked have taken over everyone and everything, including Nate's parents just to torment him. But after fighting waves upon waves of Wicked, he can summon Miradox and head back to the past. When Nate does return though, he's met with the most powerful forces backing her up, the four elite Wicked Yokai, who also beat the shit out of Unfairy for failing, so they're pretty strong. After harvesting all the spirit energy, they made machines to collect it all and put it into a cloud that's been hovering over the city. So Nate takes them down and heads to the warehouse to fight Dame Deadtime, where she's fucking cheating. The battle itself is hard enough because she can steal your levels and summon Wicked Yokai with them, reducing you to level 1. But when you get her to half health, she just rewinds time and revives herself, so it doesn't even matter. So that's where Nathaniel comes in. He finally wears the Yokai Watch Model 0, summons the classic Yokai, takes down Kin and Gin, breaks the time stone, and she can't revive anymore. So, time for some catharsis. But of course, it's the final boss, she's not done. She flies in the air and absorbs all the Wicked energy she can manage to reach her final form. Gross. Right off the bat, I'm gonna tell you this fight is way harder than McCracken's, objectively. And overall, probably the most gimmicky fight in the entire franchise. She throws pretty much anything and everything imaginable at you and almost all of it hits your team without fail. Draining your soul meters, stealing your stats and your moves, hardened spirits, tearing through dimensions to nuke your front lines, straight up blocking off parts of your watch like purifying and items, and I don't even know what this one does. I had to grind like hell every single playthrough I do of this game just to get through this fight. And that is something that will never change. So after about typically 30 minutes of team wiping, 45 more minutes of crying, and about 2 or 3 broken 3DSs, she's down. For real. The giant cloud clears, the sun comes out, and ding dong, the Wicked tribe is gone. So with Nate proving to Nathaniel that Yokai can be friends to lean on, and Nathaniel teaching Nate to live with just a little bit more moxie, it's time to return to their presence. Nathaniel promises he'll continue creating the Yokai Watch so the original can return to their timeline. And with that, it's one happy farewell for now. While I admit, in terms of plot, this game never really had the same emotional weight as the first one did for me, at least. I think in terms of gameplay, character design, and character writing, the latter two I'll get to later, it's a perfect sequel that did everything right to surpass the first one. And I wouldn't blame anyone for thinking the plot's a lot more ridiculous than the first one, considering the donut war bit going on for so long and the- But I'd absolutely be lying if I said it didn't cackle at those the first few playthroughs. And from this point on is where I feel like they really start amping up the personality to everything with their over-the-top Maximus expressions. And again, they're hitting that good balance between a story and comedy that doesn't distract you from your goal, so I really like how they did it. I'm proud of them. The Wicked is absolutely my favorite yokai tribe because of the Wicked Quintet. It's such a badass concept that if the anime took things more seriously, I think they'd make for some peak villains. Especially after playing the post-game, because in Psychic Spectres, you get the chance to battle and befriend them later on, and it's just, they're so good. Yokai Watch 2 still has all the favorites from the last game with some really spectacular upgrades. Combined with additions from the Psychic Spectres post-game and just side things that I haven't gone over yet, this post-game alone feels larger than the first game as a whole. So first I'll go over the side modes that you can get really early on, but I just wanted to save till now. Back in Harrisville, you can explore the very poorly guarded Infinite Tunnel by the path to the mountain. The only thing making an attempt to stop you is a really skinny sign in front of a gaping void reading, "Yo, lots of kids go in here and get, like, lost as fuck forever, so I wouldn't." That's just me, though. Mad respect from the whole town if you go in like that, but that's just me. The Infinite Tunnel is another daily event that's pretty self-explanatory. You walk down this tunnel for thousands upon thousands upon thousands of yards, encountering yokai and NPCs that set the creepy vibe a lot more than they should. You've got the Hyotoko trio that jump scares you when you walk past them sometimes, but besides turning you into one of them for a bit, it only makes you walk slowly for a few yards, so it's just a wacky addition. You've got the Tangler who will ask you cryptic questions that can either make the tunnel longer or shorter depending on how you answer, and if you keep running long enough, you just might run into a whole ass locomotive that definitely fits into this tunnel, that can either take you really far forward or really far back if you accept the ride. It's a dark, damp, depressing, gray environment for a while, but every couple of thousands of yards, it slightly improves with stronger and higher ranked yokai appearing more often. Once you finally reach the light at the end, you arrive in this empty, weirdly beautiful forest area where a crying child is floating over the water. For the first couple times you complete the tunnel, you'll get different backgrounds with the child slowly getting closer, but nothing really happens until the third or fourth. After that point, you'll start to see a massive faded yokai approach you, only to disappear after taking a few steps. It'll also keep getting closer and closer with every completion until about the 6th, where you start the secret boss battle with Malice. And it's a pretty easy fight, especially if you're playing post-game like I did, you're probably high enough level to just kinda cream through them. My favorite part of the secret tunnel is those environments that you get after completing it. Those and Prayer's Peak Tunnel are places I really wish I could see more of, because Yokai Watch has such nice world building like that, and the environments are really peaceful. Next, the Yokai Pad has a new side game that would be a precursor to a future title, Yokai Watch Blasters. In this one, you play as the yokai to take on Terror Time and fight different levels of bosses. You collect as many Oni Orbs as you can before time's up, so at the end, you can get a better reward from the Oni Krenkakai. I always loved the idea of this mode, but it has one big downfall being the fact that you can only play multiplayer locally. And since, let's be honest, Yokai Watch fans are kinda cursed with having no in-person friends who like the games, it was kinda hard. Revisiting San Fantastico and linking data with another version of the game can get you access to another shed containing horrors beyond human comprehension, Mystery Way. It's a huge misty maze of tangled highways stretching to infinity, split into three possible paths. There's the Bony Spirits Way for linking with that game, the Fleshy Souls Way for linking with that one, and then the Gold Gleaming Way comes from linking those two with Psychic Spectres. Each path has its own boss at the end, with some being unique to Mystery Way and some being harder recolors of other bosses. Each of them will drop a special Krenkakai coin for you to use on the machine that appears when you defeat them, and it can get you some really rare yokai and items. And finally, on each path there's one of the three Oni bosses you can fight for a chance to finally befriend them. And of course, with a lot of codes online comes a lot of special items and Krenkakai coins you can use to get special yokai, like the robotic versions of some iconic yokai or the regional yokai, which are some of my favorites. And now for the actual post-game. Hovernyan poofs into Nate's room to ask for help as something is emerging from the Infinite Inferno again, because in the world of Yokai Watch, if there are seals, they will be broken. So visiting Mr. Stone again to get the key, he recognizes Nate as he was there during the whole Dead Cloud incident where he was rescued by him and Nathaniel. He says he remembers Nathaniel as a really brave hero, and that always made me smile knowing that he knew. Unlocking the shed, you can once again challenge the first game's gauntlet of bosses in Wobble Walk, now along with the side quest sent straight from hell, fighting him over and over again for a chance that he'll drop a little glob of his void body to befriend a little mini version of him. Much more importantly though, after finishing off Wobble Walk, a shining golden rope inches down towards Nate. Climbing up it reveals an unknown dimension up above, this time a maze of golden pathing full of only happy, bright-looking yokai. This new realm, beyond both heaven and earth, is the divine paradise. As an ultimate, ultimate final trial, this one has harder versions of bosses from this game, like Captain Crash, Kin and Gin, and Dame Deadtime, each of which is debatably harder than anything you've seen in the Infinite Inferno, except maybe fucking Squiggles over here, I don't know. But they're really nothing compared to what's coming up in a minute, so even if you claw your way through all of those, may the devs have mercy on your soul. and they won't. At the pinnacle of everything this world has to offer, the ultimate, ultimate, ultimate final boss, Cat Cradle. And you know what? No, I'm not even gonna explain this one. Just watch. And I put that on 2x speed, so in the first minute and a half of that fight, their entire team was gone. But you might be thinking, oh, well, it's fine, it's a secret boss, they might just be underleveled a bit, it's supposed to be strong, right? But no, that person's entire team was level 99. I see so many max leveled yokai with like the best buffs you can imagine. All the pre-planning in the world still falls to this thing. It is literally, factually, an unfair fight. If you ever really think you're ready to take on Cat Cradle, go for it, but you're not. But you know what, let's give you the benefit of the doubt and say you scrape by the hair on your chinny chin chin. Cat Cradle wasn't even fucking trying. It's just like, haha, JK, fun game, but like, what if? And then you just warp back into your bed, sheets probably sweaty as fuck because you just got the piss stomped out of you for a whole week straight. And you get nothing. Oh yeah, you wanted an actual reward? Well, you better march your ass back up to Nirvana and fight her again for a chance. I repeat, a chance at an equipment item. But hey, at that rate, it's gotta be really good because this is the last big boss of the entire game, right? Well, the Paradise Ball she drops does give plus 50 defense and 50 speed. Exclusively for B-rank yokai and lower. Level 5, what the fuck did I do to you? And also, there's a new amusement park in the yokai world. In the base games, you were already able to visit Whimsy Valley Station, but there was barely anything to see. In Psychic Spectres, though, they expanded this into a whole new area to explore. To get there, you have to go to Sunshine Station at night and wait for a secret train to appear. This train is full of only yokai heading to a place called Gera Gera Land. There's a little problem with the trip though, as some miscreant took the brake handle. So you have to solve a little train mystery before you can get there. And, huh, I wonder if the cartoony bandit-designed yokai named Yoink might have taken it. Nate goes to return the brake handle to the conductor slash living engine, but he thinks he took it, so he's kinda pissed. So Nate beats up the, again, literal engine, and the train somehow doesn't crash into Gera Gera Land Resort. So you're free to explore the whole resort full of really neat puzzles like roller coasters, bathhouses, the giant restaurant run by Oni, the Kabuki Theater where you fight in a stage play. It's really neat and colorful. And this is a nitpick for me, I really love Kabuki as a boss, but I just wish he wasn't a giant robot performer. You know, I'm an 11-year-old with an underdeveloped frontal lobe, I gotta be a bit cautious. I'll be the first to admit that I'm a sweaty bitch over these games, okay? When I see my reflection on the 3DS screen, it makes me rethink some things hard. But as much as I love to complain, it's always just been a blast for me. Oh yeah, speaking of blast.
Terror time. It's a terrible phenomenon when evil yokai run rampant in the streets. But there are yokai with justice burning in their hearts who will protect the little guys. My yokai justice makes me feel good.
Yokai Watch Blasters, or Yokai Watch Busters in Japan, but they were not dealing with a lawsuit at their sales. This was another dual release coming out with Red Cat Corps and White Dog Squad, so they both still have their own exclusive yokai that you can find in each game and trade between versions with another person. They knew they almost had it with the minigame in 2, and I could not be more grateful that they decided to fully flesh this out because this is my favorite game in the whole franchise. This is the first game we have without Nate being heavily involved at all. Instead, we start with a rookie team of 4 yokai just wanting to make it big. The entire game takes place in Terra Time with Jibanyan, Sandman, Hydabat, and No Way as your starter team. And each of them is one of the main classes of yokai you'll find. The fighter fights, the ranger doesn't fight, the healer heals, and the tank tanks. So what's their first big target? Gargaros. First big fight? Waffle stomps so hard they have to hire a life coach. So hearing the pathetic cries of an even more pathetic team, from the ceiling comes Sergeant Burly. He yells a lot. You play purely as a team of 4 yokai just running around taking down enemies and bosses on each stage. Over time, you'll take on bigger and bigger jobs, like fighting the Oniers or saving the world from a bunch of evil yokai escaping from the Infinite Inferno again. God damn it! Okay, so yeah, the big bosses you take down throughout the story are being released by another ancient evil that was supposed to be sealed away forever. So throughout the missions, you need to collect Oni Orbs so you can level up and get stronger, and fight more and more bosses to get their materials to make better equipment over at Signaton's shop. And instead of just story missions, you can also go on normal patrol so you can recruit yokai and collect Oni Orbs and do mini missions without being on a tight time limit. And befriending yokai is actually pretty interesting in this game, as it has you do a little rhythm game to woo them, I guess. I mean, I don't know, I don't find this thing very seductive, but if it works, it works. And as usual, there's the Krankakai on the roof and loads of codes to go along with it. As for the actual gameplay, it's really simple. You got 3 buttons depending on your class, your elemental ability, and your level. And of course your soul ultimate whenever that charges. I think it's pretty neat how once you level up and unlock all your potential moves, you can swap them out at any time except for your basic A attack. And speaking of swapping, you can also switch between one of the 4 yokai you're playing as at any time during any mission. But you probably won't have to because they finally improved on the biggest issue in Yokai Watch 2's blasters. We finally got the online multiplayer. That's right, at least as of this recording, you can still join random lobbies online or play with anyone on your friends list at any time. But at the point we're at, if you don't have any friends to join you, anyone else is going to be way above you, so you might be stuck with the AI if you want to enjoy it normally. But I'll be honest, in terms of story, it isn't complex in the slightest bit. The game really is just dumb fun with a bunch of cool bosses, but basically, Wisped Cream, an evil whisper-like yokai that was sealed long, long ago and somehow escaped, has been feeding yokai bits of him to turn them evil and do his bidding to take over the world. So you find your way to him, kick his shit in, ew. Fight him again on top of a tower, punch him to the fucking moon, and become world heroes. And then you just keep going, fight cooler bosses in the post-game, they get harder and harder and harder, and it's fun. This game really never needs to be more than what it is, and I really like it for that, it's just dumb fun. Well, it was dumb fun. But unfortunately, considering the rarity of players these days, that means more than likely you're gonna be stuck with the AI. And oh my god, the AI. Spoilers for the late game bosses, I guess, but you're gonna have to hear me out on this one. If you've got a full team of 4 actual players, or at least like one other person who can actually play, fights like Zazel, Hinozal, Shogun King, those are manageable. But if you're going single player, fighting McCracken and Dame Demona at the same time, you are fucked. How about I just give you a little rundown of the typical Blaster's AI experience, shall I? So the fighters don't know the meaning of dodge, the healer and the tank are waddling around on a playdate until the healer falls into a meat grinder off in the corner somewhere, and then oops, there goes the tank, like 30 seconds later. And then the ranger contributes so little to the whole endeavor, in fact, that it took me until 5 in the morning to find a clip where someone used a ranger willingly on their team. And even then, they had to switch into the ranger themselves to revive, because the ranger, Unfairy, was busy dancing around like a little prick laughing at their grave. But yeah, I really love these games. I'd give anything to go back and play with friends because I never had any growing up who were interested in the series like I was. And I always thought it was pretty cool how they handled the multiplayer because you can get rewarded a lot for playing with someone with the opposite version. The more you play with someone from your own version, you get these little badges that let you unlock a secret boss exclusive to that game. And when you complete missions with someone from the opposite version, you can get the rewards on each mission that are exclusive to that one. So then you can get more equipment, more yokai, more things that you couldn't just playing alone. Even though I'm sure it is mainly to get their sales up, they do a really good job at encouraging you to do as much multiplayer as you can and meet with people because that's just how the game was meant to be played, it's a lot more fun that way. So if you ever find this in like a used game store somewhere or even GameStop if they still sell it, just pick it up. Tell your friends to pick it up, it's fun. After all that though, I was actually kind of missing Nate in the games, and it made me think, people really need to recognize that Nate's faced some pretty huge threats on its own that he really doesn't get enough credit for as a protagonist. Yeah, you'll probably argue that he's got the yokai fighting for him, he doesn't really do anything on his own as a character, but he's really been through a lot. Dude's literally gone to hell and back twice to save the human and yokai worlds, fought an amalgamated kraken politician whatever that is, absorbing the spirit energy all around Springdale, fought another amalgamated whatever to stop it from controlling humans all across time, and then basically ascending to Nirvana to fight Nigh Omnipotence, this time just because he can. All of this basically without batting an eye once, mind you. Look at that smug ass expression in the face of a god. Now, I'm not here to power scale him or anything, but it made me think, what challenges could they possibly have lined up for this kid after all he's already faced? Well, they sent him to America and gave him a gun to fight the alien mafia. But you didn't see that coming. Yokai Watch 3. And if you thought Hovernound was into inflation, well, just wait till you see the marketing team. It was originally gonna be another 3 version game, but it was already kinda yikes in Japan, so they just decided to combine them all for the American release. Probably because they knew we weren't going to pay for three different versions of a game where they make fun of us for 60 hours. So Nate's dad takes the family out for dinner to reveal that he's got a new job in a new continent called BBQ. Yeah, for the last game to release in the US, they wanted to make sure you knew it took place in the US. So the family's gotta move and leave Nate's friends behind in Springdale, which is probably for the best. His friends are kinda dicks. But hey, it's not all bad, just a brand new adventure with all Nate's yokai friends. Whisper sold the medallion for a new watch. Well, okay, in his defense, it was the only offer they were taking, and the other watches can't handle yokai in this country. So he kinda had to. But in not his defense, that means there's someone out there walking around with this. And whatever, that's a problem for a different Infant Inferno trip. So these three gotta figure things out for themselves in BBQ, where, assuming you have the English version of the game, they already speak English. So instead, the game gives them the worst combination of New York, Wisconsin, Baltimore, Wisconsin again, and Michigan all into one language. So with their family being harassed by the locals as they can't make out anything they're saying, a brand new yokai inspires Nate's dad and helps them translate. This is Linguist, American yokai. They really want to rub it in. American yokai are basically super bedazzled patriotic versions of Springdale yokai when fused with the Star Spangles item. And Linguist can help anyone learn any language ever. So as Nate watches a very horrific, unintelligible conversation, he befriends Linguist, who inspirits him so he can freely explore his new town. And within 24 hours of doing so, he is immediately visited by federal agents. The FBI, a duo of agents Blunder and Foley, because they suck at their jobs, are heading an investigation of rumors about aliens in BBQ. And the alien thing's gonna be a big theme here, because that's also the reason we meet our first 24/7 human partner of the series, Buck. He's convinced that he can see aliens with the power of the stone he keeps around his neck all day, but when he points out Whisper and Jibanyan, it's clear that he can just see yokai. When Nate tries to point this out though, Buck just gives him the thousand-yard fluoride stare like he's the crazy one. So from then on, Buck says it's Nate's responsibility to help him find a UFO. Meanwhile, we flash back to Springdale for a bit where, man, I never thought this fandom could hate a character this much unless it was like Mangy Mutt or something. Haley Ann is our second protagonist of this game. She's just kind of a dweeb. She likes science, space, and anime, and I don't know, she's a bit expressive, but I don't think she's as annoying as everyone thinks. She lives in an apartment in Breezy Hills and also goes to Springdale Elementary, but just never encountered Nate somehow. She goes shopping in a new city, Sparkopolis, and in her little weeb store, she finds a watch that says it can communicate with aliens. And just like the other Skitto 11-year-old, she starts getting the voices. So she buys it and takes it to a back alley where, after about 30 more minutes of flailing, eventually she finds Usapion. Dumb little space cowboy, he's our third mascot. So she goes through the motions, befriending her first yokai, who, through the power of Yokai Twitter, starts finding leads on big mysteries for her to take on. The game does require you to swap between Nate and Haley every now and then so you don't get too far on either side, but you can get pretty far with the time that you have. On both sides of the story, you'll be solving mysteries related to magazines called Fancy That's. Whenever you find a copy on one side, swapping back to the other side will allow you to make more progress. And while the general consensus for Haley Ann is just pure hatred, I think they both got some pretty good adventures. Nate's pretty by the book on his side. He gets his first big boss. He gets trapped in a zombie hellscape nightmare where he gets saved by, oh my god, I have issues. Then he visits a supermarket at night where zombies roam and he reduces their manager to a fine green mist. And then he gets to shoot a man in the woods. Speaking of which, Nate's new watch comes with a whole new battle system. Instead of the wheel, you're now on a 3x3 grid where you can slide on the metals on the bottom screen to draw a path for your yokai to move, and all of them have a different cooldown time to when they can move again. Throughout the battle, little blue and green orbs will land on the battlefield the more hits you get on the enemy. When your yokai run into them, the green ones restore HP and the blue ones restore soul meter. Different items will also appear on the field now, like the Volt Extreme to fully restore your soul meter, the stat boosting talismans, the Force Blaster will to fire a giant laser in front of you, and a lot more. Of course, all yokai still attack on their own and everything. The big difference though is the Sultimates. Sultimates now have a set range of tiles that they can hit. Some in an X shape, some in a line directly in front of you, and some randomly. Bosses also have certain attacks that can hit various ranges, with some capable of completely blocking off tiles. That's the main reason you have to watch your cooldown time so carefully. It's really debatable if this system is easier than the wheel, and I always lean towards yeah, but that's just mainly because of unrelated reasons that the game itself is easy to me. But you know what really makes confrontation easy though? A gun! During the fight with the aforementioned man in the woods, Nate gets a new watch thrown at him along with the toy blaster for him to put it into. The Dreamlink blaster lets you put metals in from your back lines to fire different types of ammo. And each tribe gets its different type of ammo. Brave gets slow-moving missiles, Charming gets rapid-fire bullets, and Slippery gets weaker homing targets, and so on. And I think giving Nate more stuff to do on his own was the right move. He needed more action. Meanwhile, Haley Ann starts her own detective agency and starts helping Yokai with their problems while taking on big adventures of her own. She's gotta fight off this kawaii dream world demon thing, she's gotta save her brother and his classmates from a yokai pedophile, no not that one, and she's got her own kaiju versus mech battle and it's pretty awesome. And we also get to dive into Usopion's backstory. You see, when Usopion was alive as an otter, he was adopted by a rocket scientist named Dr. Healy. He had always dreamed of building his own successful rocket to put it on the moon, and he promised Usopion that one day he'd go to the moon too. He worked day in and day out until finally, he got to launch day. And then... and he never touched rocket science again. So they want to build him a rocket. Listen, I'm tired, my throat is tired, it's a touching backstory, but I'm blowing past it. And so it's finally time for the stories to merge as both Nate and Haley get invited to Yopal led by Mark Orgerberg and Steve Jaws for a tour of the Yokai Watch factory. So as they both get warped, they meet at the entrance with a bunch of other yokai who are invited for different reasons. Spoilerina and Poofessor as the legendaries, Totaloo and Arachnus as a couple, and we also finally reunite with Komasan and Komajiro, and it's kinda sad because Komasan got all sad because Nate wasn't calling him. Cause he thought they weren't friends anymore, it's just like, damn it, Whisper, what'd you do? And we also get introduced to two new yokai from BBQ as a part of a superhero team, Double Time and Agent Spectre. So as they're greeted by a surprisingly dickish robot, Nate and Haley's inventories get combined for the rest of the game. That includes all items and yokai medals. So thankfully Nate doesn't have his medallion anymore, otherwise Haley Ann would be the most dangerous person alive. After that, the tour is pretty simple. Nate and Haley battle each other, they gotta fight off some invaders hunting down Steve Jaws for his autograph, they learn how the yokai watches are made and provide free child labor, asshole robot is an asshole and goes evil, you gotta blow him up, turn him into a Roomba, and then go home like you didn't just cause millions in property damage. So since Nate's basically stuck with her now, he introduces her to Buck and Buck's like, ew, dude, no, cooties. And they send her off to find a fancy that so they'll accept her as a friend. So she goes back to Springdale and does a little maid cafe mission that I don't like to talk about because I feel like I'm gonna get put on a list. So she comes back with it, boom bam bop, their trio. Meanwhile, Nate and Buck built a raft for a sailing minigame so they can go to different islands and find rare yokai and items. And they end up on an island flooded with research of the UFO. This leads them to sail to a cave where they find the Force Dude again, shoot him in the face, and oh hey, there's a UFO. And this is where the game gives you a really crucial choice. While this game was released as one version outside of Japan, it does still keep some things exclusive to one save file. So right now, you have a choice between two superhero leaders whose teams you get to recruit later on. But either way, they stomp Agent X into the dirt and the UFO flies away. Also, Steve Jaws is there too and he's like, yep, that's definitely going to the yokai world. But first, Buck's got family issues. Yeah, so out of the blue, Buck's like, hey guys, let's go invade this mansion that no one knows how to access except for me for no particular reason. So they walk into the entrance and they fall in a pit trap, but Buck's perfectly fine. So Nate and Haley have to escape by going through a long series of teamwork puzzles, mainly handing each other keys and spot the different games. And if you couldn't tell, this is Buck's mansion, he lives here. And you gotta fight a physical manifestation of his mommy issues! Then the gang gets a message from Steve Jaws saying he tracked down the UFO in Grumbler's Grotto, and that means cowboys. So grab a horse, beat the shit out of Agent X with that horse, and then we finally see our villain. By far, is the coolest reveal we have ever seen. So Nate gets to sit down for all of 6 minutes before hovering on Poofsin telling him the UFO's back. So it's time to go to New Yokai City and confront our threat. And as usual, Enma isn't here when there's a big threat, adding another universal constant to these games of 1. The seals will be broken, and 2. Enma ain't doing his job. So Nate was fully prepared to handle everything himself until he got jumped by the literal mafia. They start swarming and taking over New Yokai City, along with the previous bosses, and the heroes are not helping because they're assholes and can't fight together. So after dealing with the heroes and the villains, we need to help Komajiro take back his nightclub from- Yeah, I don't care, listen to this sick ass drum solo.
Striker! 1, 2, 3, 4!
We'll be right back.
Alright, now time for some main villain trauma dumping. The Ghoul Father explains how he was thrown into space for believing in aliens by the previous Enma for like 500 years, and yeah, that's a dick move. And then proceeds to pull out his skyscraper palace like a turnip, and that was already there, it's just no one said anything about it. Anyway, he does some more exposition explaining, and apparently that stone that Buck some reason has around his neck is some reality warping stone from an alien ship that can make his dreams a reality. Everything about the why behind this storyline just baffles me. He looks cool doing it, but he's just doing too much. And along with the tower comes this invincible barrier which the heroes can't break, so they come up with the most nonsensical ass plan I have ever seen. So the whole dinosaur and super humanoid creatures can't break it. So Steve Jobs' first thought is, let's take this very water-bound cyborg pet shark of mine and this human rocket scientist, slap a rocket on the creature, shoot it through the ground even though it's gonna fly into the tower anyway, and if that doesn't work, he'll just believe in himself. But hey, if it works, it works, and we're inside Bada Bing Tower. And oh my god, I do not like Bada Bing Tower. So first, before you can get to the top floor and fight Ghoul Father, you have to go through 7 trial floors, which makes sense, it's a final boss. But to get to those 7 trial floors, you have to spin a wheel on the elevator for a chance to land on the floor you want, every time you go in. Once you complete a floor, you can go back into it whenever you want. But to progress in the actual tower, it is all chance, and I'm pretty sure it's gonna make you go through pretty much every floor before you actually get to the top. And don't forget, it can land on a floor you've already been to, and you just gotta spin it again. By the time I made it to the top floor and fought Agent X again and he gave me that spiel about how Ghoul Father took him in when he was in a down spot, I don't care. I don't want to hear it. Too many floors. Now as cool as I think the Ghoul Father is, he is just kind of spamming meat shields this entire fight, which is both funny but also really annoying when it goes on for 10 minutes. His attacks are cool and he's a cool looking villain, it's really dragged out. Everything about him is so dragged out. The Ghoul Father's written so strangely in this game because he's like half cocky, but at the same time when he loses in his not at all serious mode, he's like, damn, I'm kind of desperate, I guess I better eat this space rock. And he does. After a single loss, he eats the all-powerful space rock, which is all-powerful, by the way, and can warp reality, so he could maybe, like, summon something a lot more powerful to murder these kids, but no, he eats it. And then, yeah, it's the gross-looking second phase. Let's go. It is really cool how this battle goes though, because his main form of attack is just saying things into existence. He is just warping reality to make his dreams a reality, and that's really cool to me. But other than that, this fight is really, really easy. Especially with the person in this footage shredding him with ease, so we're gonna skip past it. In the scene after the battle though, it's really cool that he's the first boss to full on fade away after a loss, and the first boss to just keep going after a second phase is down. You really get a feel for his relentlessness and his ruthlessness in the scene, and I really like that about him as a character. So with the stone broken, he's finally powerless and gone, but so is the UFO. And it begins to plummet. Very fast. Luckily, for once, the superheroes are done being dickwads and come to help the kids not plummet to their demises. Saving the day for our heroes, and saving the day for the yokai world. Once again, Nate has proven himself a legend among the yokai, and Haley Ann was there too. So after that long journey, Nate finally has time to go out with his parents again for dinner, where his dad has some news. Lyingwist kinda left his body a long, long while back when he inspirited Nate, so he couldn't really talk to any of the people here. Which means he's going back to Springdale! Isn't that funny? Isn't that comical? How the hell can they afford that? And that was our journey with Yo-Kai Watch 3. It's definitely the most controversial in the franchise and in the fandom for a reason, and I don't know how to feel about it entirely either. I find it nearly impossible to take it seriously for better or worse, but it's a fun type of wacky that I can replay as much as I want. It's just, I don't know. I wish with all it had, it took itself a little bit more seriously. It's a very full game with a lot to do, but at the same time, considering the story and how the characters are, it feels kinda incomplete. Like, there's no plot to go with, but at the same time, the plot's pretty good. The story for what there is of one is really hard to follow with the way they organized it. I had to go out of my way to just completely rewrite things, because if I went in their order, it would be Nate did this, and Haley did this, and Nate did this, and Haley did this, instead of just one line, which I kind of like a lot more. It's a really colorful and vibrant and lively game, and I like it for that, but at the same time, for whatever reason, I find it to be really overwhelming, and I get a lot of fatigue from this one. The music in this one was the best of all of them, most definitely. The boss theme, Rongo Swirl, all the town themes were phenomenal. This one did the best job at making all the songs feel unique to where they're supposed to be, instead of previous games where it's like the same in a different pattern. This one is just all different instruments for almost every different situation. But yeah, for better or worse, you can definitely tell they lean towards the comedy side for it. The game reintroduces a lot of unused characters though, and I really like the storylines that they put along with it. They're really good with side character specific stories, just not the main plot. But, of course, we're still not done. This game is definitely full with a lot more of the small side things you can do, like treasure hunting where you can find little artifacts just in boxes and weird spots. I still haven't taken the time to collect all of these, but it's something that I really wanted to do. It's really neat. They don't really do anything, but they're nice to find. And in BBQ, instead of the Crank Gekai, we get the Dream Wheel. Each day you get a chance to spin for possibly more cranks up to 30, or maybe as low as 1. And I like how it lets you see what prizes are there for each coin each day. And then there's Zombie Night, BBQ's version of Terror Time, this time with only Nate. And again, giving Nate more stuff to do outside of depending on his yokai is really cool. There's a lot of really good items you can get from this by completing each stage. Your main goal is just to sneak around and smack as many zombies as you can behind the head. And besides the normal zombies, there's also zombie versions of yokai that are really tough to handle. Ultimately leading up to the final boss, Hollow Guard. He's in the city hall guarding the big bell that's supposed to end Zombie Night for good. And in this game, there's no Infinite Inferno or Divine Paradise, instead you get the Zen Lightner Challenge. It's definitely an easier gauntlet in comparison, mainly because it has normal yokai instead of all bosses, but it does still end with a few really hard versions of bosses that I wouldn't expect. It does compensate for the easier yokai though, with restricting you from healing after stage 5. And the final boss of this gauntlet, Zen Lightner, is no pushover whatsoever. Obviously heavy hitter, lots of end spirits, but also he can block off tiles a lot, and every now and then he'll start doing his red light green light move, where if you're not on the spaces in the right time, which sometimes he'll block off or change last second, all of your yokai in the front lines just die, no exceptions. But what really makes this feel like a full to the brim game is what lies beneath Nate's basement. A whole nother dimension, a whole nother game really. Blaster's T is the blaster side mode done perfect. You find Burly and the rest of the Blaster's house camped in a desert dimension. The Kluvian continent is basically a rift between worlds. You play through stages of lots of ancient ruins, fighting bosses just like normal Blasters, but now every stage is 5 floors of mazes where you look for the stairs to progress to the next one, and every 5th floor is the boss. Your main goal here is just collecting treasure. And you know what I said earlier about this game being overall really easy really early? Yeah, this game is where the difficulty plummets. As you find treasure chests attached to yokai or just laying around, you'll often find these things called Clutifacts. These will get you the rewards listed on the stage selection screen. And with some of these items, the fact that you can access this early on in game absolutely breaks it if you make use of it. The insightful treasure can make any level 1 yokai a top tier team member. It makes any other form of XP grinding look like garbage. Then there's the platinum dolls and the black dolls selling for insane amounts of money, and you can get them a lot. Then there's the miracle medicine, which can revive your whole team in a battle in the normal game. And most broken of them all is the forbidden fruit with a 100% befriend rate on any yokai you can feed it to. I'm guilty of using all of these on my first playthrough to just breeze through all this stuff, because I don't like grinding to befriend things, and I don't like grinding for XP. But at the same time, it just kind of makes the game boring after a while, because everything's level 99 now, and I don't have anything else to work for. But at the same time, for quest yokai and daily event yokai, I am not holding back on Forbidden Fruit. I am not doing daily events. And also, they're just so hard not to make use of with all the ways you can boost them with auras and things. And even without all those, the dungeons are lined with silver dolls and really good healing items that you can just find regularly, and you will find them a lot. But hey, at least the bosses put up a good fight gatekeeping those items, because the AI got worse. Now not only do they not know how to dodge, they run into every attack, including the healers. Half the time, I have to dodge for them to make it through a lot of bosses. Blasters is a game I'll never shut up about wanting friends for, because it's just so much better. And now that the main story's over, this actually ties into the plot a bit. As it turns out, once you reach the final stage, the Pyramid of Clue, the alien stone starts to glow again and the Ghoul Father emerges. When he was fading away during the final fight, he was actually just putting himself inside of it until he was ready to come out. So he starts absorbing all the treasure around him for one final shot at his dream, and I really like how relentless this dude is. He does not know how to stop. And as you might imagine, the fight with the Gold Father is pretty much impossible with the AI. But it's a really good fight, and I love the Ghoul Father a lot. And that's one thing I really want to appreciate, is that if Yo-Kai Watch 3 does nothing else right, it does the characters right. Because you can finally recruit so many nice yokai like Enma, or the Treasure Yokai, or Cyborg Y, or Egg, or... It's something that really makes me want to talk about one of my favorite aspects of Yo-Kai Watch as a whole. The designs. Now, to discuss their designs, I made a chart of three categories which I think mainly fit their style. Cute, cool, and plain fucking weird. To which they overlap to various success. And kicking off the cute category, we have Jibanyan, you know, the Pikachu of Yo-Kai Watch, as people want to call him. I was debating putting him more in the cute and cool section, but he's a little bit too... round, I'd say. He gets his cool moments, but he can't be too cool, otherwise we couldn't make him a plushie every 2 seconds. He's just a cat, and we like him like that. And I like his design. I like his wisp tails, I like how his ears got a chunk out of it because he's, you know, dead. He's a cute little guy. Now on to Komasan and Komajiro, one of the most beloved duos in the entire franchise, and I'm pretty sure anyone can see why at first glance. They're squishy. They got the matching swirly backpacks to show that they're just a couple of country bumpkins moving to the big city, and look at them, they have no idea what they're doing. Well, mostly Komasan. There is not a hint of thought going on in that brain. He's one of those characters you see and you're like, yeah, I really want to hit him with a cartoonish mallet. And then you'll see a plush of him later on and you're like, yeah, I still really want to hit him with a mallet. This man is far too doofy to be taken seriously in any situation, and we love him for that. Fucking look at him! And then we got Walkappa, who I really have nothing special to say about. He's just kind of a dude. He's one of the first spirit-based yokai we get in the game, so he's a good introduction to the more useful elemental aspects of the battle system. And with him being based on an actual yokai, obviously the Kappa, he's just always kind of felt like a mainstay to me. Next up is the cute and cool category, which is mostly evolutions of the cute yokai to show progression in a team while still keeping the mascot-like. Starting this off, we have Komain and Komiger, the evolutions of Komasan and Komajiro respectively. I like how their backpacks turn into superhero-like capes and their poofs get bigger because they keep collecting spirit energy. And now my baby boys are strong and they are pissed, look at them! Also, their medals look really cool, I don't pay attention to those nearly enough. Blizzari is the evolution of Frostina, and she is so cool for literally no reason. Wait, no, scratch that, there's a huge reason. Her hair clip gives her the power to freeze a super volcano in that tiny form. I just really like the Snow Queen gimmick overall, and she's just an iconic yokai to have on her team, so why not? Apak shows his mastery over water by getting rid of his bottle for an amulet that lets him channel it through a sword, and I just think that's badass. His hair, I think, grew out to be more like those straw hats you see on a typical samurai, and his little Hawaiian skirt thing keeps a surfer dude vibe going, and I really like that. And you know what, I'll be the first to say it, Tanjiro wants to be him so bad. Now onto the cute and fucking weird category is the designs that were almost mascotable but just had something that wouldn't let them in. Now I know Whisper definitely fits more under the old British man who can't use technology to save his life, but I can still kind of put him in the cute category, I mean he's got such a dunkable body, look at him. I always thought it was pretty charming when he stripped the fuck out in his suit, living his nightlife as Slender Man. And you know what, I'd say I'd even got some love for his Will Smith for bit, I guess. Or at least it's kind of charming in the manga or the games, but in the anime it becomes a trend of basically body horror. They can be doing the most mundane activity in the show and the Wisp will just turn into this inexplicable evangelical beast and I really don't like it. And I don't think it's really better that this was technically a Christmas episode, so yeah, that's the fucking weird part of the category. Moving on from that into the straight fucking weird category is what you might have expected already, it's the gag yokai. For the sake of comedy, Yokai Watch has a trend of designs that just boil down to ass, feces, snot, more snot, pedophile, are you laughing yet? Now, I'll be the last person you ever find saying Yokai Watch isn't funny, but these designs just aren't nearly as appealing as I hoped, even if their target audience was those kids in the 2010s. It's just a bunch of shovelware yokai that no one wants to recruit now because they're not useful and they're just not fun to have on your team. But even if they don't hit the mark on looking funny, Yokai Watch does a really good job at making them funny with their character, so I'll appreciate them for that. Now, cool and fucking weird is the most interesting category to me because this is the direction I feel Yokai Watch as a whole kind of takes their designs. As this is where I put pretty much everything else, this feels like filler yokai but in a good way. You'll find a lot of C to A rank yokai here, a lot of yokai you'll find throughout the story and keep on your team for a while until you figure out your mainstay team in the late or post game. And I find these designs to be a really good thing as they give you the best general feel for what yokai are. And that's why for this category I really want to highlight the classic yokai because when you see these in mythology for the first time, that's kind of your first thought. They're cool, but they're really fucking weird looking. Some may stay on your team for good if you really like them, and some may just be there to get you through a hard battle and get kicked out later on, but really you can't go wrong, they're just really good to have with you. But even more than that, what I really, really wanted to highlight here are the boss designs.
The bosses were always my favorite look. I always loved the way the bosses looked, like Spryank was so funny looking to me. Just a giant pig in a hot tub, who I also voiced. That's one of my favorite characters to voice. He was fun. But yeah, I thought the bosses always looked great.
Now for the bosses, at least in Yokai Watch 1, it's really apparent that they're going for the big, burly, intimidating sort of shape while keeping a kid friendly. That's why they all end up so round. But I do think those designs reflect their characters really well, especially, say, with, like, Spryank. He looks exactly like how he fights, he's big, middle-aged, and throws soap at you in anger. His fighting style is really cheap and cowardly, and that's reflected really well with him just looking like a dork. And even though a lot of future bosses are slimmed down a bit with their designs, the big ones still do a good job of being intimidating, they're just built like a shit brick house, that's a dangerous thing to encounter. My favorite boss designs are easily the first stages of the final bosses, especially with the Ghoul Father. I like how instead of being this giant, extravagant ghost wizard, Ghoulfather's just kind of a man in a suit who can beat your ass. And I really love his design going along with the way he fights, because while he does use some magic-looking attacks, most of his fight in Yokai Watch 3 is just him running them hands. But of course, along with the final bosses comes their second phases, and they have a really, really weird theme of tentacles. Lots of tentacles. With the exception of Yokai World Chairman Squidilius McCracken, there needs to be a limit on tentacles. Wait, Squidilius McCracken, really? I know the weirdness is exactly what they aimed for, but it's hit or miss with me. But I like them. A lot. And now we move on to my favorite category and definitely the longest. The cool designs. And you can tell, this is where all the efforts went. You're gonna see a lot more higher ranked yokai here, mainly the A to S ranks because of course they're gonna save the best of the best for the end of the game. God, I just want to instinctively see them in a shonen series on their own. I'll never shut up about them. But yeah, this category is where I'm gonna go off a bit, because we got a selection here. Now, I want to start off with Venox, Kyuubi, and Tengu specifically, because they're like a classic trio of S-ranks that are somehow not actually classic yokai. Venox, to me, really feels like the perfect design to act as the player's first S-rank yokai. He's got a really simple and sleek design, which, yeah, I know. And it's got just enough flair with the snake scarf to set him completely apart from everything you've seen up to the point where you finally get him. He's perfectly edgy and mysterious to me, and I wish he got a lot more focus in the anime and manga. Especially since he had such a good story potential backing him up the whole time, they explored it a little bit in the anime, but he just didn't get fleshed out enough. Now, Kyuubi on the other hand makes it very loud and obvious from the jump that he's way beyond you from your very first encounter with him.
Kyuubi was one of the ones where I'm like, dang, like, these designs are actually really fire. Man, I'm kind of old school, like Kyuubi. Like, we have Robo Kyuubi, we have Dark Kyuubi, look at that. But Kyuubi in my opinion, he's like, okay, the upper, what an upper echelon yokai is supposed to represent. And I still think he's one of the strongest designs in the series.
And I like that he acts as a recurring antagonist for Nate just to fuck him over and test him because he's bored. And he keeps up that energy in every appearance in the franchise, no matter how many times Nate defeats him and befriends him, so you gotta respect it. Along with just being a really good standalone yokai, he also makes for a perfect duo with Vinok, because, you know, I know. And even though it's kind of a copy and paste, I really like that the series stuck with them being rivals. Okay, now for my boy Tengu. He's one of the few yokai on the small and wacky end of the spectrum that I enjoy looking at, and honestly, he's been in my top 5 since I first got into Yokai Watch. Him being designed like one of the cartoony long-nosed Tengu as opposed to what they're actually supposed to look like just fits him so well, because he's another one of those fuck over the world because he's bored type of yokai. He literally has no major part of any plot of anything, and you can tell he's perfectly fine with that. He shows up, waves his fan, causes millions of property damage, leaves, doesn't elaborate, and I love him. And to my memory, I don't think I've ever had a team without him in any of the games. He saved my ass in every Wobble Walk fight and every major fight I've ever struggled with just because of his Typhoon fan going that hard. Everything about his design just looks really cool to me and flows really well. I love his sandals for no reason at all. One thing I do wish I could change though is that even though his fan and his model is fine enough, I wish he had the fan in his key item that you need to unlock him in the first game, because that Typhoon fan looks so awesome with the way it glows. It's definitely a nitpick for me, but I just think it was a really easy missed opportunity, but that's all, I still love him. Alright, next up I want to talk about, oh shit, is it actually time? Oh, do I get to talk about them now? Oh yeah! Oh, my absolute favorites, I finally get to talk about them, Aragnus and Total Dude. My absolute favorites of all time, these two are a huge reason I consider to be Yokai Watch 2 as the peak of character design. The more and more I look at these two, the more appealing they get to see, especially when they're together. Because I spend a lot of time seeing them together on Pinterest. A lot! While the art style of the games makes a lot of cool yokai look a lot more doofy than I want, I can't really knock the artists when I see them, because they're just that cool regardless. Of course, with them being opposing war generals for most of their afterlives, everything's gotta have a lot of contrast. Aragnus is the more by-the-book tactician type, you know the drill. So he dresses a lot more modestly with baggy clothing like his hakama pants and how the sleeves of his kimono are always draped down. And while his giant rope belt probably has some other meaning I don't know, I think it helps show his overall reserved style. His inspiration from the actual yokai Tsuchigumo gives him his spider theming with his hair and the web design on his kataginu. And I'm sorry if I'm mispronouncing any of these, I'm just reading off of Yokai Wiki. That combined with the wider array of vibrant colors not only makes his fit go hard as fuck, but it also shows he's still got an unpredictable side under all the walls he's put up. On the flip side, Total Dude doesn't know the meaning of modesty. Like, I'd actually believe you if you said it's canon that he has to look up the word on the yokai pad when you told him to dress modestly. You see him rocking a sleeveless vest with a bubble design and a slightly longer, flowy kimono underneath, both with a really nice frog foam-like lining, but not to mention the fucking hammer pants? It's impossible to see him and not think, hey, this man's cool as hell. He got his name for a reason, he's just a total dude. But what really sells the contrast with Aragnus is the hair and the color schemes for me. Despite the way he dresses and the way he acts, his hair and color scheme make him considerably more well put together in comparison. While Spider Shogun's hair is a mess of short spiked legs and flippers, Total Dude's just got one long clean ponytail. While the former has a wild mix of vibrant, warm, and cool colors, the latter is more consistent, sticking with mainly greens with small details of reds and yellows, and just enough blue on his face markings to stick out without taking away from the flow. It shows that he can still hold his own mentally and act responsibly, it's just not his style. Even with them taking up most of the segment, I can't stress enough how perfect I find their dynamic and how much potential there was and still is for them to be more major characters. But I am happy with what we did get out of them, and I'm really happy with all the eccentric artwork I've seen of them. Yeah, you know what I mean. And it really helps seeing them come back as literally best friends in Yokai Watch 3, like at most a year after Yokai Watch 2. They can use the 60 years excuse all they want, but nah, Nate summoned them all the time before that. So I'm just like, nah.
Nah, he gotta be pregnant.
Now, most of the Wicked Tribe can be boiled down to the basic gas cloud creatures taking over a good classic yokai, making them into something evil. And it's a really good concept that I really liked at first, but I wish they did more to actually change the yokai to make them look corrupt instead of just, heh, I drew like a dark, fucked up version of Palisol. I gotta let Aragnus and Total Dude take up the segment a little bit more because they remind me of a good idea of what Wicked Yokai could have been. I'm talking about Arachnival and Total Demon. You find these in Yokai Watch Blasters on a secret stage. From what it reads in their Medallium entries, they're supposed to be completely separate, unrelated yokai to Total Dude and Aragnus, but they just look like perfect examples of just evil, wicked yokai. You know, change up their color scheme a bit, give them some extra demon-like features, it looks really good. You could even give them the same color scheme as the elite wicked yokai, anything but just giving them a gas mask. The tribe is just a lot of wasted potential, but the elite wicked yokai somewhat make up for it, so they're still my favorite by far. The cool category could go on and on and on with all the S-rank yokai I really like. Now, as a shonen fan from the early years of my life, I'm clearly gonna click more with the cooler designs. You know, the ones I can just stare at, pop on a song I found on a TikTok edit, and then go ham on some choreographed fight into my head for like 30 straight minutes. Yokai Watch's designs just really hit with me. Even the ones that don't really hit with me, they hit with me. Now, I get that there are gonna be a lot that push people away, like, I'm not a huge fan of Obaga either, but just because of the E-ranks, people overlook some really good masterpieces in the series. I see a lot of complaints about the recolored yokai as they feel like filler, but I really like them. They feel like alternate skins you gotta unlock, and they work. The art style, though, definitely holds a lot of them back. I'll preach to that until the ends of time. But that just really makes me appreciate the fan art even more, so thank you to all of you who actually love the series and keep making more of that for me to look at. And anytime I take some time out of my day to really focus on these designs, it makes me think, they could have been so much more. And it really makes me sad to think about, not just what could have been with these designs, but what could have been with Yokai Watch. Over the years, it seems they really lost their identity in that regard too. When they did try to go a new, more serious direction, I can only imagine. It just felt unnatural at that point. After Yokai Watch 3, we were just in a really weird spot. With it coming out at the very end of the 3DS's lifespan, almost no one was paying attention to its already limited release. And their fear of Yokai Watch's failure wasn't helped with their poor launch sales in Japan for their next title, Yokai Watch 4. And because of that fear, they gave up on localizing things altogether. They promised that Yokai Watch 4 would make a Western release back in 2019, but since then we've still heard nothing of that, or Yokai Watch 1 for the Switch, or Yokai Watch Busters 2. Yokai Watch Wibble Wobble shut down in US servers, Yokai Watch World shut down, everything just kinda died. I can completely understand the worry with Busters 2 with the Switch already overshadowing the 3DS. But then you have two really good looking Switch titles that you just won't release because one game failed. But that same game only failed because they wouldn't release a lot of English copies because they were worried about the toy sales failing. It seems that along the way, they really lost heart in this franchise, and I always just kind of thought that was really unfair. Unfair to the fans who still love it unconditionally to this day, but also, people were really unfair to them. Something that I loved, something that I grew up thinking I was the only one who loved as much as I did. From the very start, it was set to the standards of the Pokemon killer, and then that got reduced to the Pokemon knockoff, but it was never going for that. And then seeing all the openly, very shameless knockoff Pokemon games get all the positive spotlight, it doesn't make sense. What I love about Yokai Watch doesn't come from any revolutionary storytelling or gameplay or graphics. While it does what it does really well compared to everything else to come out around it, I would have to just call it average. As an 8-year-old watching that trailer for the first time and not knowing anything that's going on, and now as an 18-year-old recording this and uploading this video today, I look back and I'd still think, yeah, it's really nothing that special when you think about it. But that's really what hit me writing this script. Maybe that's exactly it. Maybe that's why Nate's such an appealing character. Because under all the themes that Yokai Watch might want to teach you, Nate carries a really important one that no one talks about. That maybe just being average is alright. Over time, as his character grew, he wasn't afraid to be average anymore. He wasn't using yokai to impress people, he was just helping them. And the same could be said for the games and the fans who still love them. The games weren't afraid to be average, they were fun the way they were. And us fans still know we like a really unpopular franchise, but we stick with it. And maybe I'm exaggerating this theme, maybe I just internalize it because I never personally think I excel at anything. And whether the writers or creators really know it or not, Yokai Watch can have a very, very unintentional theme of self-actualization. Because at the exact same time, you may be the most average person in the room, but you are still the most special person in the world. And that's why I make this video, really. Because if I can have the slightest window to get people's attention to have it grow over here like it deserved, then I will do anything to get that message out there. I personally don't believe anyone saw Yo-Kai Watch for what it was and what it could have been. And maybe, just maybe, what it still could be. Because if nothing else, it's fun. And this video was fun to make. I got to interview some really amazing people that I never could have imagined I'd talk to in my life. And even more who sadly couldn't make it for this video. And every time I take a look back at this franchise, every time I see the designs, every time I rewatch the anime, every time I replay the games, there's always something that I either didn't notice before or didn't have a full appreciation for before, but I do now. And this time around, after all the people I've had interested in joining this project, it's the community. I never really took part in interacting with fans online, and I didn't really watch many YouTubers who played it. I only met one of my friends who likes it years and years ago, and after learning that he liked it, it lit me up inside. Knowing that there is still a fanbase out there, and knowing that there is still fan art out there for me to enjoy, really fills me with an indescribable hope. Maybe not hope for a return, but hope that it still matters to someone. For the longest time, I thought I was the only one who could like Yo-Kai Watch as much as I do. And to some extent, that statement still stands, but I'm happy to know and meet everybody that I did, for this project and just throughout life. Working a lot of sleepless nights on this project, it really helped me to know that I'm not the only one who still cares. Not by a long shot. Are there any last messages you'd want to give out for the video?
Just keep watching the show, keep playing the games, keep it alive. Keep it, you know, it's never died.
It's just, it's, like, play the games, like, at least play the first game, or the second game. The second game is really good.
1, 2, 3, bring back Yo-Kai Watch.
Bring back Yo-Kai Watch.
Bring back the Yo-Kai Watch.
Bring back Yo-Kai Watch, please!
As ridiculous as it sounds when I try to make an emotional ending, I am really thankful for everyone who joined me and how this turned out. And if the fans really do still believe in the series as much as they seem, well, maybe we might just have one more shot after all.